In the last video, we created this falling Tetris piece, and I think we did a pretty good job, but something that you might not notice when you're watching the video is that the controls actually feel a little bit off. They just don't feel quite right. If I tap and hold the left arrow key, you can see it has a little delay, and then it starts moving a lot. We didn't really do this intentionally, but when we use the when right arrow key pressed and when left arrow key pressed blocks, it sort of behaves the same as if you're pressing a letter. So for example, if I press the A key, I'm in this little sprite name input, if I press the A key and hold it down, you can see that I'll get one letter A and then a bunch of them a second later. This is pretty standard behavior on a computer, and it actually works pretty well even in the context of this Tetris piece. We do want to have this sort of one click and then a delay and then you hold it down and it keeps going. But the settings on this just aren't quite right. There's too much delay at the beginning, but then the piece moves too quickly later on. The other problem with using sort of the built-in way that this works is that different computers can behave differently. So someone on, you know, one computer or someone who has changed their settings might be able to move the piece faster than someone who is using a different computer or a different set of settings. And so what we want to do is, rather than relying on the built-in behavior of the when pressed block, we want to use our own if statements and our own sort of manual checking to make sure that we have complete control over the timing of how the block moves. So in order to do this, we are going to take all of these when pressed and turn them into checks using an if statement that checks if we're holding down the arrow key. So we're going to check if the right arrow is pressed, and we're just going to put this code that used to be happening using this when pressed event, and instead it's going to happen inside this if statement. And of course we need to run the if statement somewhere, and so what we'll do is we will put it inside of this update falling piece. So right now this entire thing just checks if it's time for the piece to fall, and if so it does it. What we want to do now is add in this right arrow check. And we'll do the same with all of the different arrows. So I will add a left arrow check, and of course this custom block is going to run every single frame, it already does, and we're just sort of using it not only to make the piece fall, but also to do our keyboard controls. So I've got the right arrow, I've got the left arrow, if I can put it in the right spot, and now we're going to do the up arrow. Now you might notice right away that we're going to have a problem, which is that the piece is going to move very quickly because it's going to be checking every single frame. You're no longer going to get any delay at the beginning like we had before. And so our controls are actually going to get worse right now. So let's try playing again. And you can see that now, as soon as I hold the arrow key, I can move back and forth. And this includes spinning. I can spin really kind of ridiculously quickly in a way that's not actually that helpful. In fact, it's really hard to just spin once. It kind of always spins. Well, there I'm getting it a couple times, but it often spins more than just one rotation. So this is actually worse than we had before, but it's going to be a step in the right direction. It's going to help us get to where we want to be. Now, right now, we're just checking whether the key is pressed, but what we actually want to do is have our if statement think about how long the key has been pressed for. And so if you're in sort of that initial delay period, it'll say, okay, even though the key is pressed, I'm not going to run this action. But if you're later on and you're sort of repeating a bunch of times, then it maybe will. So in order to make our if statements more clever and make them think about more than just whether the key is being pressed, we need to measure how long the key is being pressed for. Now there's no block in Scratch, there's no sensing block that lets us know how long has a key been held down, but we can certainly do it ourselves. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a list, and I'm going to call it key hold frames, maybe. And this will keep track of, for each of the four different keys, how long it's been held down. And we'll make it for this sprite only, I suppose. It's not super important. But what we'll do is, right at the beginning of this script, we are going to reset key hold frames. We'll sort of reset the list just to say, contain some values that mean that the keys haven't been pressed at all. That's how we're going to initialize it at the beginning of the project. And so we will just do that right at the beginning. Then every time before we update the falling piece, we will say update key hold frames. So let's run this right before we update the falling piece. And so then our update falling piece block can use our new key hold frames list to know how long each key has been held down for. So let's see, I'm going to move these blocks maybe to some place that's open so that we can do a little bit of work here. This looks good enough. So this list is going to contain four different items, and each of them are going to start at -1. So we'll start by just saying clear everything out of the key hold frames list, and then four times add a -1 to the list. And it's got to be the list key hold frames. So we'll reset it, and you get these four negative ones. And each number here, the -1 doesn't really make sense, but each number here is going to represent how many frames has a particular key been held down. And so maybe, I'm not sure exactly what we'll do yet, but maybe list item 1 is the right arrow, list item 2 is the left arrow, that sort of thing. And so each of these list items, maybe 1 will be 4, and then you'll know, all right, the right arrow key has been held down for 4 frames now, 4 loops through the forever loop that's running our entire project. So in order to do this, oh, and by the way, -1 is going to mean that the key is not currently held down at all. So in order to do this, we'll start with just handling the right arrow key. So what we'll do, and remember that this block is running every single frame, we'll say if you're currently pressing the right arrow key, we will increment this. We'll make the number go up by 1 to say you've been holding it for a whole nother frame. Otherwise, if the right arrow is not currently pressed, we will make list item 1 go back to -1. So that's the easy part. We'll start with what's easy. We'll replace item 1, because item 1 is going to be our right arrow, with -1 if you're not pressing it. But if you are pressing it, we want to increment it. We want to say replace item 1 with its current value. We're going to grab its current value, and we're going to add 1. We're going to replace its value with its current value plus 1. This is sort of like using a change variable by 1 block, but instead of a variable, it's a list item. So there we go. That'll do the right arrow, and we can just try this out real quick. If I hold down the right arrow, you can see it counts up. It goes to 0 and counts up, and when I let go, it goes back to -1. So this is perfect. Now, in our other script, our other custom block that handles the keyboard events, the arrow keys, we'll be able to use this information to make a better script. But all right, we don't just want the right arrow. We also want left, up, down, and eventually I think we're also going to want space, the space key, which is why I have 4 list items here. We're not doing anything with space yet, but we'll start keeping track of it just so that we're ready when we do want it. All right, the left arrow is going to be list item number 2. So all the scripts are the same, we just switch it to a left arrow, and we switch it to changing item 2 of the list instead of item 3. Then we'll do the up arrow, or I mean instead of item 1. I was thinking 3 because I was typing it, because the up arrow is number 3. And then we'll also keep track of space, even though we're not using it yet. Later on, we want to know about the space key as well. Alright, so now I've got the right arrow, I've got the left arrow, I've got the up arrow, and I've got the space key. All right, there we go. So we're keeping track of these 4 different keys, not only whether or not they're pressed, but also how long they've been pressed for. All right, then what we want to do is we want to update our script here that is just currently only checking whether or not the key is pressed. And I think the first thing we want to do is make it so that when you press a key, not only it doesn't just move every single frame. Right now you can see every frame, every time we go through the forever loop, the piece is moving either to the right or the left, one grid space. I think what we want to do is make it so that it only moves every other frame, that it sort of skips one. It'll move a frame and then not move a frame and then move a frame and not move a frame, even if you're consistently holding down the arrow. And that'll just make our piece move at half speed, which I think is going to be better than the current sort of super fast motion. So how do we do this? How do we take a number, a 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, that sort of thing, and turn it into a true-false? Essentially, what we want to do is know whether or not the current number being stored in here is even, Because if it's a zero, we've held it down. If it's a zero, that means this is the very first frame that we're pressing the key, which is good. We want to move then. We don't want to move if it's a one, but we do if it's a two. Not if it's a three, but yes if it's a four. And you can sort of see the pattern. We want all of the even numbers. Now the trick is figuring out, how do we make an if statement that says, if the right arrow key is pressed and item one of the key hold frames, we're going to say if item one is even and kind of put that in here. The question is, how do we check whether it's even? And the mod block, sort of this modulo operator, is going to come to the rescue. For now, I'm going to put three in here, and we'll just talk through what modulo does again. If I do 0 mod 3, what this is going to say is do the division problem, 0 divided by 3, and then give me the remainder. And in this case, the remainder is 0. If we put a 1, it'll say 1 divided by 3. We might think of the answer as 1/3, but if you're doing it in terms of remainders, the answer is 0 with a remainder of 1, and so we get 1 as our answer. If we do 2, the answer is 0 with a remainder of 2, and so we get that remainder as our answer. If we do 3, 3 divided by 3 is 1, and there's no remainder, and so we'll get a 0 again. Now, if we stop thinking about this in terms of remainders and just start looking at the pattern, you can start to see that we're essentially counting from 0, then 1, then 2, and then back to 0. 1, 2, and so on. So we're going 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2, 0, 1, 2. And so whatever number we put in here will never actually hit. We'll just jump back to 0 when we get to a multiple. Now this is useful if we put a 2 in, because remember, our goal is to detect even numbers. So if I put a 0 in, I get 0. 1, I get 1. 2, I get 0. 3, I get 1. 0, 1, 0, 1, and so on. And so anytime that I put an even number in, an even number divided by 2 is never going to have any remainder. It's always going to give us 0. And so, I got a fun little sound there. That was interesting. If I have an even number, I'll always get a remainder of 0. And so to check whether this number is even, that's in the list item, because remember, the even frames are the ones where we want to move, we're just going to say, if when you divide it by 2, you get a remainder of 0, that means that this number is even. And if this number is even and you're holding down the right arrow, then we should move. So now, if we go left, it's still fast, but right, you can see moves at half speed. That's perfect. It still looks fairly smooth. It's of course a little choppy because it has to move one grid space at a time, but you can see we're getting that nice every other frame motion. And that's going to make it just a little bit easier to control the piece as we're moving it. But of course, left still goes fast, so we can fix that as well. Now that we've done the first one, it should be fairly easy to do the others. We can just copy most of this code and say, well, instead of checking list item 1, we want to check list item 2, because list item 2 is where we're storing the left arrow key information. So now both the right and the left arrow keys are slowed down. Now the up arrow is still pretty fast, so we can try changing this as well. And we'll do essentially the same thing. We'll say if the up arrow is pressed, and actually what I'm thinking here is that the up arrow is going to be a little bit different. With the up arrow, it never really makes sense to hold it down, to hold down the key and have it spin a bunch. It's very rare that you would want to do that, and in most Tetris games that I've played, that's not an option. So what we really want to do is just say the very first frame that you press it, then it will go, but after that it never goes again until you let go and re-press the arrow. And fortunately, this key hold frames list is actually super useful, because we can just check whether the list item that we're using to check the up arrow, which I believe is list item 3, if that item is equal to 0, that means it's the first frame that we've pressed the arrow key. After that, it's always going to be 1, 2, 3, it's always going to be bigger than 0. And so if we just include this check, is it equal to 0, then this script will only run on the very first time that we press the up arrow. So I can press the up arrow, and I'm still holding it. You can see list item 3 continues to go up, but my piece never turns again until I let go and press it again. So that way, with turning, you have to press the key. That's what I'm doing right now. I'm pressing it over and over again. but if you press and hold, it's only going to turn once. But again, our right and left arrows, you can still hold. Now there's one last problem, which is that I don't want to have the controls sort of move continuously right away. So right now, if I press the left arrow, it just starts doing the every other frame movement right off the bat. But if you remember when we had the when key pressed block, one thing that was kind of nice about that is that you have a little delay at the beginning, and then it starts moving as you hold it down. So rather than checking for every single even number, we want it to run on 0, and we definitely want it to run on like 6, 8, 10, and so on. But on maybe 2 and 4, I think for those two frames, it still shouldn't move. We want to say, do every single even number except 2 or 4. And that way, you'll get frame 0, and then not until frame 6 will you start doing the every other frame sort of movement. And so you'll get that little delay at the beginning. Now, there might be a clever way to program this to like check if a number is equal to 2 or equal to 4, but I don't know exactly a super clever way. And so I think instead of trying to be really fancy with it, we're just going to be super straightforward and say if the number is equal to 2 or equal to 4, we're going to say don't move. So we're just going to add an and not. We're going to say, if all of the current stuff is 2, every other frame, and it's not equal to 2 or 4, then you can go. And so this does turn into a bit of a monstrous little if statement. It looks huge, but it's not really that complicated. And to be honest, I'm okay with this. I don't think it's much of a problem, even though it's a little bit large. So again, we'll do the same thing here. We'll say, we're going to check if either the current item, sort of the number of frames that's been held down, is equal to 2 or equal to 4, and we'll say when that's the case, even though it's even, although it's true that it's even and we say every single even frame move, in these certain cases, don't. So we're going to say check that it's even and it's not equal to 2 or equal to 4. And again, this makes kind of a big block, but it's not a huge deal. Although it is covering over my key held frames script here. So maybe we'll move that over. All right, let's try this out and see if it works. All right, if I hold the arrow key, I get a little delay at the beginning. It's pretty subtle. It's not a very large delay, but I think it is working. We're saying, and it's not equal to 2 or equal to 4. Yeah, I feel like it's good. You hold it down, you get a little delay, and then it keeps going. So if I want to move one, it's pretty easy. I can just tap and it moves one at a time. One, one, one. But if I hold it down, it still feels like it moves pretty responsively. All right, I feel good about that. There's one last thing that I want to do, though, before we finish, and that's to add the ability to press the down arrow. Now, when you press the down arrow, it's supposed to do what I believe in Tetris is called a soft drop, where it's going to make your piece fall faster, but still allow you to control it. And so this is actually a super fun feature to add because it's really easy and it makes your game better. All we have to do is say, right now we're falling when the piece fall timer is greater than 15. So you can see this down here, it's counting up from 0 to 15, a little bit like how our list items were counting up from 0 going up. But here it's every time it hits 15, the piece falls, and then it resets the fall timer. But what we want to do is say, if you're pressing the down arrow, just always go down, regardless of how that timer is going. So we say, if the fall timer is greater than 15, then fall, or if you're pressing the down arrow, then fall. And this is just a super easy feature. You can see now, I can hold that down arrow, and the piece falls, but I can still sort of slot it into place when I get near the bottom. All right, I feel like we've made a lot of improvement to our controls here. In the next video, well, to be honest, I don't really have a plan yet, but in the next video, we'll add some more features, we'll do some more cool stuff, and it'll be a lot of fun.